Windows Virtual Desktop, gotta have it, don't know how to do it, don't know why you want it, but you know it's important? Well, rest assured, I got all the answers coming up for you right now. Hello, everybody. My name is Adam Gordon, an edutainer here at ITProTV, back with another episode in our What is Azure serial. We're going to be focusing on Windows Virtual Desktop in this episode, and as we continue our conversations about all the interesting new and innovative technologies and features that Microsoft's making available on the Azure platform, we always answer three questions. What is the technology or feature we're examining? Why would you want to use it? And of course, how do we actually deploy it and get it up and running? Let's begin by talking about what Windows Virtual Desktop actually is. It's actually old technology. It's been around for some time, conceptually anyway. The idea of being able to provide virtual desktop experiences for remote users in a variety of different situations and circumstances is not new. It's not new to Azure. It's not new to Microsoft. As a matter of fact, it's not new at all because many companies, some of the biggest technology companies we think of, have been providing virtual desktop experiences, and Microsoft has been among them for decades now. Citrix, certainly, VMware, Microsoft, and many others have been doing this kind of capability, providing it, making it available to us for a very long time. But moving it into the cloud, making it available in Azure, is definitely something newer for Microsoft. And when we think about the reboot that Windows Virtual Desktop really implies as we move the older remote desktop capabilities that Microsoft had in their on-premises servers available to us to be able to provide virtual desktop and remote application session support and move it into the cloud, combining the idea of remote desktop or virtualized desktop interfaces, what we call VDI, along with remote application sessions, we now get the capability to have full desktop and remote app support made available, but provisioned through Azure. And so Windows Virtual Desktop is all about combining this idea of providing the desktop and the remote applications that go with it and making them available as a consumable service through the Azure platform. Now, we want to understand that when we do this, we're actually going to be splitting our responsibilities and our focus. And what I mean by that is, and you can see at the top of each of our areas here, part of the solution is going to be provisioned, managed, and set up initially by us, managed by you. When I say managed by you, what I mean is you are going to make the decisions about what kind of desktop operating system you want to provide your end users that are going to use this service. You're going to provide and decide on what kind of remote applications you are potentially going to serve up and virtualize. Maybe it's the Microsoft 365 application space that you want to virtualize. Maybe it's something else. And you're going to have management and policy oversight and capabilities that allow us to control that, create user access control around who gets to use these environments, what kind of networking is going to be available to support them. All of that is going to be done by you as you make your initial choices. But then there's a part that's going to be managed by Microsoft and provided and ultimately overseen by them. And because we have this split in responsibility, we now can really begin to understand and answer the second question. Why would we want to actually use Windows Virtual Desktop? Well, we know we can provide virtual desktop and remote application experiences, but because the complexities associated with doing so can be very problematic, we want to understand that this split in responsibility is really going to let us streamline the complexities, really make it simple for us to do this and think about doing it at scale with the backing of the Microsoft Azure Fabric and the cloud data centers that are regionally distributed globally around the world, bringing remote desktop capabilities and remote app capabilities to any and all of your users, everywhere they are. And Microsoft takes over the most difficult elements of this and really makes it seamless for us. You're going to see exactly just how easy it is when we answer our third question, how do we do it, in just a few minutes. And I walk you through the setup initially of how we make the choices around what kind of clients we're going to support, what management diagnostics capabilities we bring to bear, the broker service, the gateway, and of course our load balancing elements. Many of these are defined by us initially during the setup wizard we go through to create our host pool, one of the key elements that's very important for us to work with Windows Virtual Desktop. And then once we set that up, Microsoft takes over that complexity and manages it all for us. We get to leverage and use all the things we're already familiar with and used to in the Azure platform, our compute, storage, and networking capabilities. But again, they're provisioned and overseen by Microsoft so that we don't have to worry about the complexities associated with understanding the health and diagnosing problems and load balancing our traffic for these virtual desktop environments. Microsoft does all that for us. We like the fact also that we're given choices here. One of the other compelling reasons why we may want to use Windows Virtual Desktop, why for you, it may be very important, is to think about the operating systems. As you can see, I'm pointing to them here, that we have options to use. Windows 10 Enterprise is going to be one that is probably going to be very important for us in the modern environments we operate in. Many of our end users, whether they're in an office or these days, because of all the disruptions we see in the world, many of us are working remotely, but Windows 10 is a standard solution for many corporate environments today. We like the fact we can use Windows 10 with or without the Microsoft 365 apps already bundled in and made available as part of the virtual machine that we're going to create and serve up in what we call a multi-session solution. That multi-session designation is very important because the operating system image that we use to serve up the virtual machine that becomes the launching pad for all these full desktop and remote application experiences must be multi-session to support lots of users connecting. And we can have hundreds of users simultaneously in these systems working because of that scalability. But notice we also have Windows 7, Windows 7 Enterprise. That is probably a little unusual for many of us, thinking that we already know that Microsoft's really moved away from Windows 7 and has come out and said definitively, support is essentially over, even though they are providing free initial and additional security updates during the transition period. But we do provide Windows 7 for backwards compatibility and special use cases in environments where you still need Windows 7 to run. And as a result of that, we can use that and still have that capability, and we get those enterprise security updates that Microsoft's committed to making available to keep this environment secure. And we have server operating systems as well, Server 2012 R2 or greater, meaning when we think about this, Server 16, Server 19, all the modern infrastructure servers we need and are running to provide file services, directory services, name resolution services, web services, database services, the list goes on. All of them are available here and can be made available as virtual environments that could be fully equipped and made ready for our users. So when we think about the you versus Microsoft conversation, we really see the value proposition in why this is such a compelling technology, because we get the ability to specify what our users want, how we want it to be managed, give some basic information to Microsoft, and then that complexity is abstracted away. And all we have to do is then just envision our users using the platform and maintain it going forward. So as we combine these areas together and we put them together, what we ultimately get as a result of this, right, is the ability to run multiple users connecting through, right, into this area. We'll just put some users over here, whoever they are, whatever they're doing. All of them connect into this environment and can all use this platform at scale, hundreds at a time if necessary. I'm going to show you how we deploy this next. And once we get done taking a look at how, you'll have all the answers to all the questions about why Windows Virtual Desktop is such a compelling proposition for you. All right, everybody. So it's time for the how. Let's roll up our sleeves and get right down to it. Windows Virtual Desktop is one of the services that's provided in the Azure portal. I've already logged in and made it available so we can select it. We can simply go in and either search for it right up top in the search box, or if it's one of your shortcuts because you're already using it, just simply select it and we can jump in. Unlike some of the others we've looked at across the What is Azure serial already, where we have to first configure it, install it, and set it up, we start with the Windows Virtual Desktop service available, but it's really just that, a shell that has a bunch of stuff we have to configure. And so what we see under Manage is that we have host pools, application groups, workspaces, and users, all the raw building blocks and elements we need, and we're invited to create a host pool right over there on the right. And the host pool is the very first thing we have to do because that's going to provide the infrastructure and all of the information we need to then allow workspaces, application groups to be bound to that, and ultimately users to be assigned so they can get their Windows Virtual Desktop. So we're going to go in, I'm going to start by creating a host pool right here. We're going to have a wizard. It's a tabbed interface. We're used to seeing this and working with it in many of the areas we go through. Provide some basic setup information, like the name of the host pool, what location and what data center around the world from Microsoft want to put it in, what resource group. And then we'll go ahead and we'll add our virtual machines. We'll specify what image we want, Windows 10 or whatever. We'll set up our workspace, and then we'll be able to go ahead and take a look at what a finished solution looks like, because this takes a couple of minutes to set up. I'm going to create a brand new resource group for this. I'm going to call it the Adam WVD. As long as we get that green check that indicates we're good, we'll click OK. I'm going to give the host pool a name. Call that the Adam WVD pool 1. Again, as long as we get a green check, we're good. Regional location association for the data center, choose whatever works for you. Validation environment is interesting. We can set up an environment that's like a pre-staging environment where we can test the changes we're about to roll out, maybe a new application's being deployed or something like that. Or we can decide we just want to push everything directly to the users, not have any testing. So you choose yes or no here as necessary, and you see it doesn't change anything, but it gives us that additional capability in terms of the setup. So we know that, and then we have host pool type down at the bottom. And we have two options here. Let me just pull this down so you can see this. And you'll see right there we have personal and pooled. Pooled, which is shared, means that users will be able to access all of their user data, personalization, et cetera, as Microsoft points out, using something called FS Logics, an additional application capability we have to bring in and configure as part of that. So we can set this up. Most companies will probably choose pooled. That's the traditional way we do this. And then if we choose pooled, we have to set a max session limit for number of users. Let's go in and say we'll set that to 16. And we specify a load balancing algorithm. And the load balancing algorithm, breadth first or depth first, just so you can see that, is specifying whether or not we're going to try to spread the user sessions across the hosts that are available or pile them all up on one host till we're almost full and then go to the next one, kind of filling them in as we go. It's really a question how we choose to optimize and deploy our solution. We'll go with the default of breadth first and just leave it for now. We're going to click next, go to our virtual machine tab. Now we can add virtual machines into the pool right now, or we can do it afterwards. It's really up to us to decide. Microsoft gives us that flexibility. If we choose yes, we're then gonna have to specify the build information for the VM. We have to specify where to put it. It'll stay in the default resource group along with the host pool unless we choose differently. What size, memory, CPU, storage, et cetera, we want from a performance standpoint for the VM. Can take the default or change that as needed. And then once we've done all that, we have to provide some additional information, the number of VMs that we actually want to deploy. Let's say we're going to deploy, 25. We could put up to 400 VMs into a pool at any one time. A name prefix, right? That will be what gets appended to all of the infrastructure that's created as part of the pool. Then we have to specify for the host anyway. We have to specify the image type. And the image type is where we get the operating system image for the VM. We can do this from gallery, meaning what's already available in Azure, Windows 10, for instance, Server 2019, or a storage blob. We may have our own custom image we've uploaded to Azure. That's where that Windows 7 Enterprise option comes in that we talked about at the Lightboard. We may want to use for an image because maybe we still have applications that are backwards compatible that we need to provide and make available to remote users. And we could do that ourselves if we choose to. So we choose the image type. I'm going to go with gallery. That allows me to then select an image from the pre-built list that Microsoft makes available to us. Notice Windows 10 is there. Server 2019 is there. The older operating systems, I said, like Windows 7, are going to have to be uploaded as a custom image if I want to choose them. Notice also we're using the multi-session version of Windows 10, the enterprise multi-session version specifically. That's only available through Azure. That's available through the gallery. So we have to, again, note that. And we have that option of just the OS or the OS with the Microsoft 365 applications already made available so we can configure them and add them as part of our subscription, rolling them out to users, making it much easier for them to become productive immediately when they start to use this desktop image. And we like that. That's a really good thing. So we're going to go ahead and just choose our image, whatever one we're going to use, what kind of hard drive, standard, premium, SSD-backed, or traditional spinning platter hard drive. We'll make our choices there, noting there may be an upcharge depending on the nature of the storage we use. So just be aware of that. And then network and security, again, we're making choices here about the virtual network, the subnets, the IP addresses, what are we providing? Remember I said Microsoft manages all this stuff for us, abstracts away the complexity, but I also talked about when we were answering the why and the what questions at the Lightboard, the fact that we have to make those choices initially as we set up in order to ensure that Microsoft knows what we want them to do for us. And you're seeing we can do all that right here. So we have those capabilities right here. We go through. Down at the bottom, we need the administrator account. We need our admin or AD domain join UPN, whatever that will be. We need our password, and our password has to be confirmed. We're not too worried about that right now. But we'll go ahead and we'll put in our mic at itprotvdemo.com. That is our account. We'll put in our password, whatever that password is. And oh, it needs to be, right, I forgot. Okay, so we got that. And then we're gonna click next for workspace. Again, same option. We can add a workspace later or add one now. It's up to us. If we choose yes, we can use an existing one or add a new one, give it a brand new name. Go in, do that, Adam, WVD space one, like that. Click OK. We then do tags. If we have any metadata tags, we do review and create. Wait for that to show up, validate, good. We would then go ahead and click create at the bottom, just seeing all the selections we made. We'd be off to the races, so it would take a few minutes to deploy, everything would be good. Now we're not gonna deploy it because we're not gonna wait for it to finish, but I already have one built, so I wanna show you what that deployment would ultimately equal. So let's go over here. Let's go to our pick list, and let's come down here, and let's go to resource groups because we wanna see what this thing actually deploys for us and what it looks like. When we go to resource groups, I'm gonna come in here to my MS900 resource group, which is where I have all this deployed. And right down below here, let's just give ourselves a little more room on the screen so we can see that. We get all of this stuff that gets done. We get our workspace right there. We get at least one, perhaps more than one virtual machines based on the choices we made, the network interface, the storage disks associated with that, and availability set to scale those VMs. We also get, scroll down so you can see the bottom area there, our host pool and our application group. All of that is a result of the choices that we made during the setup wizard, and then we can start to manage these elements individually. And speaking of managing them individually, if you want to see more about how to do this start to finish, really get under the covers and roll your sleeves up and get into the details of this, join me over at ITProTV, as I always invite you to do. We go through how to set up Windows Virtual Desktop, we show you all the ins and outs, and we always make sure you know what to do to become the most productive IT professional you can while using the Azure resources we focus on here in our What is Azure serial. I'll be back with more exciting opportunities to talk to you about Azure services solutions and really cool new things. Microsoft's always rolling out on the platform, but until I come back with another episode, I'm gonna wish you happy Azuring, and I'll see you soon.